Hello photography fans, you're probably wondering, what the hell's going on? Why am I sitting in green light? I'm not, I'm sitting in my bathroom. And no, I'm not sitting on a toilet. And I'm here because I want to start a video. It'll be a long video. And it will be about paper negatives. I've noticed that YouTube lags those videos. There aren't any of the videos that talk about paper negatives. Why paper negatives? Well, let's start from the simplest reason. I got this 5x7 Corona camera. Okay, it's a home portrait view camera from around 1930. And as you can imagine, 5x7 film can be extremely expensive. And yeah, if you really want to buy it and shoot it, sure. But I don't want to spend that much money on film. So I've decided that I'm going to shoot paper negatives with this camera. And paper negatives are totally different. Shooting on paper is totally different than shooting on film. Okay, and first of all, paper is really slow. I've done some tests on my graphics camera and I've learned that my paper, which is here, it's Oriental resin coated paper. And that paper is around ISO 4. So compared to film, this is a glacier speed. Why am I choosing resin coated versus fiber-based paper? Well, first of all, it's cheaper. Second of all, it's easier to work with. Resin coat paper, it has natural flatness to it. So after it dries, it's flat. After it, when you first take it out of the box and you slide it in, it doesn't curve. It's just it's naturally flat. So here I have a box of 5x7 Oriental paper, and like I said, I've done some tests, and here are the conclusions. When shooting under tungsten light. Okay, so I've been doing some portraits with it. When shooting on the tungsten light, 500 watt incandescent bulb, shut into a 43-inch umbrella, close to the subject, I'm getting ISO 4, and I'm getting about a contrast is equal to about grade 2 paper. I forgot to mention that this paper is variable contrast. Okay, I also have grade 2 paper, but I happen to have this for different reasons, so I just use it for that. So it's contrast is easy to control on under tungsten light, okay, incandescent light versus sunlight. As you can imagine, sunlight has a lot of blue. Paper is extremely sensitive to blue light. All right. And so when you're shooting outside, you have to use filters. And what filters, you ask? Well, yellow filter is fine. And I happen to have a box of enlarger filters. So I just take grade 1 filter, I put it in front of the lens, and I expose expose per meters on reading. And to meter the light, I use incident light meter, so it's not reflective. Sometimes it is reflective, but for portraiture I use incident light meter, and I go per meter saw reading. And paper, since paper is really slow, the exposures are long. For portraits, you're looking about 4 second exposure under 500 watt bulb. Outside, however, it's a little bit faster. You're looking about, the fastest I've got was 1/25th of a second. that I had to use my Graflex for that. So then what you do, once you get the paper negative and you develop it, then you do contact printing. You just stick two together and then you develop them. And you shoot light on it and then you develop any chemicals. So what I want to do in this series, actually it will be series, one long video, maybe two parts. I want to take you through the whole process. I want to take you through installing the paper negative or paper in my plate holders. Then I want to take you through the shooting process. And eventually I want to take you through the developing process and contact printing and the final result. Paper negatives can be extremely, extremely addictive. Once you get into that, it's a black hole. You just really don't get out of it. And something that's stuck in my throat. So for me, when I started shooting digital, I kind of went into this, into film and into older cameras, and now I'm in such a black hole, such a deep black hole, the deepest end of it. I don't see myself going back. I do shoot digital, but it rarely happens. So let me reposition the camera and I'll show you how I load the papers and what process I need to do before loading. And then next time, I don't know if it's tomorrow or the day after, or a week from now, I'll take the camera out and I'll shoot some pictures. I'll show you how it's done. And then we'll go back to my dark room and then we'll develop the pictures. And after that, we'll we'll go ahead and go through the whole process. So, let's load the paper. Alright, so we're back, and I had to cover my camera's viewfinder because it's emitting some blue light, and I don't want that to damage my paper. So anyways, first thing is to prepare the plate holders. So we'll just put out the dark slides and set them aside. I got five of those, so that gives me 10 exposures. And here I got some previously loaded paper just to check for fitments. I'm just gonna toss that because that's already exposed. All sorts of light. Of course, this preparation doesn't have to be done under safe light, but I'm doing it under safe light anyways. I like being under safe light. I feel safe under safe light. Alright. Make sure my camera's not doing anything crazy. Here's what we do. Since 5x7 plate holders I'm not really 5x7. They're more like they're more like 4 and 15/16 by 6 and 15/16. So unfortunately my 5x7 film now paper won't fit into the plate holder, so I have to trim it. And I use my trusty film trimmer. It's actually a paper trimmer that I got a while back, and this thing is extremely good for trimming anything. It's a roller trimmer. It's really old, probably from late 60s, but it's called Genesis Safety Trimmer. It's really good. So I got my paper. I just took out a couple of sheets. I don't want to take out all 10 because just in case something happens and it gets all fogged. So I'm going to set it to 4 and 15/16. Trim it, and then 6 and 15/16 and trim it. Now you have to look for emulsion side. Emulsion side is the, in my case, is the shiny side. And damn cough. And here's what I do. Since it's just like the foam, you just slide it in. Close the dark slide, flip it over, and do the second one. Maybe I should have just trimmed all of them and then did the installation, but that's okay. We'll do that. So 1/16 off into the sink. And then 1/16 off into the sink. And then second sheet gets loaded in. As you can see, these images, these 5x7 sheets are huge. And that will work really well for contact printing. And you have to understand that paper, enlarging paper, acts just like the old emulsions of early 1900s, or actually late 1800s. So it has the same same sensitivity to light. And yeah, screw this one up. And what else is cool is that when you develop it, you could just yank it out of the tank or out of the tray, and it'll give these smudges and all kinds of weird artifacts. And you could pretty much have your own artistic way of working with this. So you could have your, like, as if almost a signature way of developing. I just develop it normally. I don't have any artistic artistic signature. But some people do. I mean, it depends. Not an artist. I just do it for fun. That's what defines amateur. Amateur means a person that does it for a love of doing it. So anyways, another two sheets are cut. I grab my placeholder, flip the safety light trap, slide it in like this. Close it and do the second one. Look for emulsion. Emulsion is one with a sheen to it. Close it. Put it away. Now I'm gonna go ahead and do all the other three, the leftover ones. But what's cool about paper negatives is that you develop them by inspection. Not unlike film. Film, you don't see the film being developed. You go by a certain amount of time and you have to do different variation of developing. Here you see what's going on. If it's getting too dark, yank it out, rinse it underwater, put in a different developer, put another developing bath. And you can mess with developer a little bit. I'm using Dectol, Kodak Dectol developer, but I'm using it at the higher dilution. Instead of 1:2, I'm using 1:3, 1:4. And if the paper is exposed properly with correct filter and the contrast is fine, 60 seconds developing and you're good. And then I put in a stop bath and so on, and I dry. So I'm going to stop the video, and this will be done for this part. Hopefully next time I'll get to take the camera out and show you how I shoot those paper negatives. And hopefully the negative paper negative gods will be good to us, and we'll be able to capture some good images. Alright, so stay tuned. Hello photography fans, this is the second part of the video that I'm recording about paper negatives. I'm actually on the way to take some pictures on using my Corona View camera, and I'm gonna take you with so you can see how that goes. So until we get to the location, I'm gonna stop the video and then I'll start recording when I get there. Okay, so just walking to my first destination, this guy that saw my camera got intimidated by my recording device on my head and kind of ran away, didn't want to talk to me. But let's see what we can get at the first location in. As you can see, it's still a lot of snow here, but it's still the middle of the winter. However, we got temperatures and upwards of 40 degrees, so some of the snow is already melting down. Anyways, so I'm here on location, and I found this pretty interesting view, I think. I want to take a picture of that. So first thing I want to do is measure the light to see what I'm getting. And even though there's a lot of snow and my meter is going to get wacky, I'm not going to compensate for that, because I know there's a lot of blue light scattered around. Even though the sun is behind clouds and somewhat behind the building, it's still pretty bright. So I set my ISO to 4. And I'm just going to take a meter reading, and it's giving me half a second at f22, and I'm just going to shoot f32 for 1 second. So that's my exposure, and to cut down the contrast, I'm going to use the zero filter, enlarger filter, in front of my lens, and as you can see, or not, it makes the light pretty yellow. So hopefully that will cut down the contrast, and it will make my shot about grade 2 contrast with this actually zero filter, not number 1 filter. So I'm just going to go ahead and put this filter here, get my shot set up, and restart the video. Well, maybe you can see or not. When I'm composing the shot here, and I think I'm good over here. It's pretty sharp. I don't have a magnifying piece, but it looks pretty good. So I'm just going to go ahead and close the lens, install the plate, and go from there. So as I said before, I'm setting my lens to f32, and I'm going to do 1 second exposure, so it's going to be pretty fast. Just open and close, and I'm going to put the filter in front of my lens, so that it cuts down the contrast.
Alright, let me grab the dark light because I'm not sure how light the camera is. Just gonna drape this over the back. I'm gonna dig out my filter. My lens is not obstructed. Take out my dark slide. Now film is ready to expose. It's paper, so it's going to be 1 second exposure. 1. Done. Just going to push this back in. Filter away and move on to the next location and see if I can get there. Okay, I'm walking to the next location and it's just one sheet of ice over here. So I barely move. Nobody just shit. Oh man. I feel like an old person. It was up the hill, on ice, no fun at all. But look what I found. I got this old house over here, and unfortunately it's sun right behind me, right in front of it, so hopefully it will make for a good picture. We'll see. Thing just slides like freaking crazy. But we'll see. Gonna go ahead and pull my plate out, set the shot, and restart the video. Andy is back, and here I'm trying to compose this shot. I'm just gonna go ahead and take that. At f32, we're shooting 1 second. We close this lens down. Unload the plate, which, if I remember correctly, number six was exposed. Now number five. I sure hope so. Alright. That's loaded. Oh, crap. So that's loaded. And I'm gonna dig my filter out. Take this 1 second exposure. One. Done. So this plate's been exposed. I'll just put it away. Both the sides were exposed. I don't know why people walking here if it's so freaking slippery. I gotta pay attention to my stuff rather than people. I don't know if you can hear me, it's windy as heck. But alright, let's hopefully move on to the next location. And hopefully I won't fall and break this camera apart and it works out. Thank you. I've been wobbling. My lens is on. It doesn't matter. It's for a different video. As you can see, I'm too cheap to buy a real dark hole last time I was using this. I think that gives me a pretty sharp picture. What do you think? Meter the light. Okay, give me 3 seconds at f32. So that's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna dig my plate out. And note the number which I'm shooting, which is 25. I'm shooting 25. Close down the lens. F32. Put this on. And dig out my filter. Pull out the dark slide. Three seconds exposure. One, two, three. Okay, so here's a little selfie of me and a ground glass. Anyways, this is my next shot. I think I like it a lot, and I like how the trees, the branches gonna be in the foreground, and this the house gonna be in the background. And I'm gonna set this up now. At 5.6 is my lens's largest aperture. Let's get underneath the polyester sheet. Now let's see what we get. Meter. Whoa, F15. 167, you crazy. 1 second. It's probably the snow. So I'm gonna do... Oh no, I'm not gonna compensate. And that should give me shot I want. But since the snow is adding into the equation, I'm gonna do 2 seconds exposure. Which number am I shooting? I'm shooting 23. Remember that. 23. Alright. Cover my lens. Pull the dark slide out. Find my filter. Push the dark slide in. Alright. And move on to the next location. So I'll scout around and see what's here and we'll go from there.
Hello, photography fans. So after a day of shooting, we're back in our darkroom / bathroom to develop the prints, the negatives. So here I got the cassette, and I'm gonna pull out the first sheet. Actually, it's the second sheet. I already tried developing the first sheet, and it's coming out good so far. So I'll dump that in developer. A little bit about chemicals. I'm using Kodak Dectyl, and I'm using it a little bit higher dilution. I'm using it 1:3, so one part of developer, 3 parts of water. And I'm using Ilford's Alpha Stop Bath 1:19 standard dilution, and I'm using Kodak Fixer, just straight stock solution. I'm not diluting that anyhow. So I got my sheet, I'm putting in my developer, and I agitate it for a little bit. Highlight should come out first. And here they come. Got my highlights. My shadows are coming in. You have to understand that we've used that number zero filter. So that filter helped to keep the contrast down a little bit. When you're shooting indoors and you're shooting with incandescent light, you don't really have to worry about contrast, because under standard incandescent light, paper, whether it's various contrasts or graded, it's about grade 2. Then you might have to bring up the contrast using different filter, but I wasn't when I shoot with the incandescent light, there's no need for that for me. Alright, so
we have the shadows, they're coming in. A few more seconds and I'll put it into stop bath. And you have to understand that paper doesn't have such a big latitude of exposure latitude that film does. But so your hi-hat's gonna get blown some places. I mean, alright, so there's my negative. I'm gonna put it in the stop bath. And as I mentioned in my previous video, how do you know when the developing process is stopped in the stop bath? Simple method, you just take your thongs and rub the paper a little bit. You hear that squeaking, that means the developer has washed off and your print is now, your developing process is stopped. Here I have my stop bath, my fixer. I'll keep that paper in it for a little bit longer. I'm gonna grab the second sheet and do the same thing to that sheet. Right. Put it in the developer. Agitate it for a little bit. Highlights are coming in. And the shadows are nicely falling. This is the magic about darkroom. You sit under this orange or red light and you put seemingly pure white piece of paper in the chemical. And hey presto, an image comes out. If that's not magic, then I don't know what is. When I first saw that, when I first did that in my darkroom, I was amazed. I was blown out. Blown away. I was, wow, look at that. So let me agitate my fixer a little bit more. As you can see, the print is developing pretty nice. There's some shadow details. Highlights are probably going to be blown, although blacks don't always look pure. Let me rephrase this. On the red light, if something looks pure black, doesn't mean it is. Okay? You of course can't see that because I'm in night vision on my camera, so everything looks kind of greenish. Alright, I got some shadow details that are good enough for me. I'll move this fixer print over to my wash. I have my bath towel. And I'll agitate that a little bit. Alright. And here I'm going to move my print from my stop bath over to my fixer and let that fix for 3 to 4 minutes while I'm while I move this, you should remember this is the blacksmith shop, and I'm gonna put that in stop path. Let that sit here. My trays are 5x7 trays, so I can't really put tons of paper in each tray. I have to work slow, but it's alright. Not like it's end of the world. I can do it right. Alright, another sheet comes out. That's the second sheet of the day. Well, actually, it's the fourth one. So we got two more left to do. Agitate it. Wait for highlights. Highlights are coming in. Shadows are coming in. It means, because when I was doing these tests with my Graflex, I would take my camera out and just shoot per meters or recommendation. And what I would get is pretty much black picture. Then I've read somewhere that paper is not really one fixed ISO under different light conditions, and under, let's say, bright sunlight, the ISO might jump up to 8 or 16 even. But I did some tests, I've done some tests, and it wasn't the case, in my case at least. It turns out that ISO does remain the same, in my case it's about 4, but it's the contrast that screws things up. So, and overexposure on my part. So what I did was started using filter, and like I mentioned before, the filters are just standard enlarger filters that you can just put them in front of your lens like you've seen me doing, and that will hold the contrast. Let me dump this here. 2 sheets, yeah, that's all right. It's quite okay. You can sit here and be friends. Now, it's probably 90 seconds or more, because I'm doing it by inspection. I'm not really going by recommendations. This is not fixed science. You have to guesstimate, you have to do tests, and then you'll know where you want to be. Okay, I'm gonna do one more, and I'm gonna pause the video, and then I'm gonna show you the washing station, and I'm gonna show you the fixing station. So, magic. White piece of paper goes into some kind of liquid. You swish it a few times, you wait, and hey, you got an image. Highlights, of course, always come first. This is just like the early emulsions. This is the picture of the old cabin with an extremely icy path around it. Some people do recommend pre-flashing your film with your paper, which means you just expose it to light so that you can get better details and shadows. I didn't really need that, but if I ever try that, I'll maybe there maybe it helps, but I never really needed it. Just agitate it and leave it here, and I'm gonna agitate my my fixer. Alright, I'm gonna stop the video now, and I'm gonna go and change my camera's orientation, and then I'll show you the washing, and I'm gonna show you the fixing. Alright, so here you can see my, let's go over here. You can see my washing tray. It's just sitting in a bathtub, it's full of cold water. And that tray is just 16 by 20, big old tray. And here's my fixing tray. That now just became empty. And then what I'll do, I'll just keep these prints here washing for about 5 minutes, and every 30 or so seconds I agitate the tray to get some water flow on these prints. And here I'm putting another one. And what I do here is just, it's really cramped with a camera. But what I do, that after the print is put in the tray, I agitate it a few times just to get the juices flowing. And here I'm stopping another print. And I got one more to do, and it'll be the sixth print or sixth image we shot together. And when these are dried, we'll set up for contact printing so you can see how that works. And the filters are doing really good job, because I got the first image we took, that's the image of the snowy icy landscape, and the contrast seems to be holding the snow pretty well, only the filter, because that was very high contrast scene, and the filter is doing job extremely well. So I'll stop the video now, and I'll restart it when these prints are in the wash and when they are in daylight, so you can in a normal light, so you can see what's cooking. All right. There's one more thing I wanted to show, and that's my homemade film dryer, a paper dryer. It's just a piece of 22 gauge wire attached to at each end of the wire there are two hooks. There's a hook, and that hook is attached to little hook attached to the attached to the wall tiles, and that's how I dry my prints. Yeah, that's pretty cheap way, but that works. So I don't care. And you see the nice thing about resin paper is that it's naturally flat. So even as it dries, it doesn't curl. Unlike fiber-based paper, which curls into little taco shells. This one just stays flat. And then after it's dry, I'll just put it away until next time when I'll be doing contact printing or scanning. You can just go ahead and scan it and you're done. Or you can do contact prints. Both ways are fun. Both ways are, and you look at 5x7 negatives are just huge. And here's the little dragon highlight. I don't know what the hell that was, but it looks pretty cool. So yeah, it dries nicely, and sometimes I go ahead and cheat and take picture of those as they dry, and then I invert them in Photoshop just to get idea of what I'm getting. All right, until next time, guys.
Hello, photographer friends. This is the last part of this video about paper negatives, and in this last part we're going to talk about contact printing. What is contact printing? Contact printing is basically printing a negative onto a piece of paper, or in our case a paper negative onto the other paper, to create a negative by contact, by sandwiching. So you take two pieces of paper, sandwich them together, as you will see in a second or in a couple minutes, and to create a negative. So all the white bits or light bits will become dark bits. All the dark bits will become light bits. And like with any printing, we're gonna have to do a test print, a test sheet. So I got my chemicals set up, like from like yesterday. I have my developer 1, 2, 3 solution or dilution, and I have my stop bath, and I have my fixer over there, and I have my wash in the bathtub. And I'm gonna get it ready. And I said I would be using my 500 watt light, but with such a strong light, you're looking at 1 second, 2 seconds printing or exposure times. So I've opted to take my to use my larger, and I got my, it's a Bestler 23C2, and I got it for $120 off Craigslist, and this lady that used it professionally sold it to me, and it's extremely good condition. She took great care of it. She said she's been using it for years. But anyways, this video is not about larger, it's about contact printing. So we took 6 shots yesterday. We developed all of them. You saw the video, you saw the prints or the negatives. But I decided to contact print this one. I like this one the most. And I decided to do this one. And I'm gonna stop the video, I'm gonna get it ready, and I'll restart it. And we'll see how that comes out. Lights off. Okay. So, first thing, we're gonna create a test print. And for that, we need a clean, a new piece of paper. Right here. Put that away. And put this away. In here, I got a just plain old sheet of glass. And the glass is going to help to compress 2 sheets together to keep them flat. So here's what we do. Make sure the motion side up, and then the motion to the emulsion. Just align those. Put them in the middle of the baseboard. Cover with the glass. Now what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna start my enlarger, and I'm gonna do 3 second intervals, and what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna first do the exposure, and then I'm gonna cover portion of the image, and I'm gonna do the second exposure. And so that the whole image will get 3 second exposure, then the one part of the image will get 6 second exposure, then it will get, next part will get 9 second exposure, and so on. I'm gonna do like 3 or 4 of these strips. So let's see what we can get. 2, 3, 3 cover portion, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, and then last 1, 1, 2, 3. All right. Now I'm gonna take my put the negative here. Take my exposed piece of paper and put it in developer. agitate it, and we'll see what we get. So the image comes out, I'm gonna keep it here for a little bit longer. Alright, so here's the test image, and as you can see there's different exposure times. This is 3 second exposure, 6 second, 9 seconds, and 12 seconds. And I know it was exposed right because, or developed for long enough because of the black edge that tells me that developer did its job. And so now we gotta choose the exposure. This is 3, this is 6. Here the snow is a little bit gray, it's not really pure white. Here the snow is white and there's still some details in it. It's not blown out completely, there's still some details. Sky is blown out, yeah. It was a sunny day, as you could see. And there's just no way to hold the details in the sky unless we use the filters or whatever. But we didn't. And here you can see is our dragon pattern snow on the roof that was black in our negative. Let me fetch that. It was black in our negative, and now it's white in our positive. So I'm gonna determine that I'm gonna do 4 seconds at f8. What equals f8? Yeah, it's f8. I'm gonna do 4 second exposure at f8 for our but this is too dark, that's 12 seconds. Snow is not really gray, it's actually white. So this is white, and I'm gonna do 4 second exposure. So let me just toss this. Off it goes to the sink. And lights off. And let's do 4 second exposure. Alright, so we're getting our print. See, you can trip in this place. Where's my little rag? I gotta put the night shot on so you can see what's going on. Cover my camera so it doesn't contribute to fogging my paper. Alright, let's grab that. See, when you're working without camera, you don't have to think about that. It's one thing off your head. But I really wanted to show you guys how I do it. So I hope this process will explain it. And it might actually spark some interest in you guys when it comes to paper negatives. So again, let's sandwich those two suckers together, line them up. One day I gotta make me a proper contact printer. I don't want to buy one because I'm really frugal. I just want to make one. Alright, camera, action. 4 seconds exposure. 1, 2, 3, 4.
off the developer. Something happens, something comes out. You have to understand that under red light, everything seems darker. So blacks look blacker, grays look grayer, and whites look darker. All right, now off to my stop path, and my battery on the camera is dying, so I'll stop the video now and I'll pause it. I'll stop it and I'll restart it when this thing is in final fixer and wash. But I think we got it. If not, we'll do it again. This is the beauty about darkroom. You can spend a whole day or more on one print. I'm not Ansel Adams, but he spent a week on the print to get it right. Because after the print dries, it changes a little. So maybe not, it may not be what you want. Right? Off to the fixer, let it fix, and I'm gonna pause the video and restart it when we're done. Alright, so here's what I'm seeing. It's last seconds in the fixer, just agitated for a little bit longer, and I think it looks good. The snow looks white with details, so we're good. The highlights were capped, at least in the snow. That was due to that filter I've been using. I was using the number zero contrast filter. The roof has some details. The snow on the roof has details. The house, the walls have details. They're about middle gray or mid gray. And the sky is blown. Well, that I can't help. It was either this or sky. And that's our dragon. So I think it looks good. I'm going to put it into wash. Let it wash. And I might do another print of something else. If I have time, it's already like past 9. I got a curfew. And when we're done, I'll hang it and then I'll let you look at it before it's dry. And that's it. And after that, I'll put this video together and hopefully it will be like 11 hours long so you can watch it. Okay, guys. Okay, so the prints are drying. And I don't know if you can see it from here or not. Camera tends to make them a little bit darker than they are, but I took the liberty and I did two more test prints on the blacksmith shop, and that's the house that we did. Last bit of information that I forgot to mention is that if you're having some issues with contrast, you can just use an enlarger filter, number 1 or 0 or 1.5, whatever. You have to do test prints and you'll see which number you're going to need to help you with that. So I think that you can see from here, it's details everywhere inside in the building. The building was kind of orange, as you can remember. maybe deep orange. Paper is not glossy, it's called pearl, it's like a semi-gloss. You can see the details in snow. This is the dirty walkway, icy walkway. So I'm pretty happy with these. There's always room for improvement. But make sure you copy, make sure you comment, and until next time.